sewers. This is the Turtle Power Podcast.
This is your audio source for all the news, reviews, and insight into the world of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. Now join your hosts, Brian, Alex, and Darby.
Bossa Nova!
Bossa Nova?
Chevy Nova?
Oh,
excellent!
Now it's time for the Turtle Power Podcast.
That's right. Hey, everybody. It's Ryan coming back to you with another episode of the Turtle Power Podcast. And I am currently riding solo, let's say Casey Jones. But I will be having a guest joining me here in just a few. I have the distinct honor of having Mr. Scott Tofte of Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Minute podcast joining us. We've talked about this podcast for a long time, basically ever since I first found it. And I think we're going to have some fun when he gets on the line here. But before we do that, let's talk about some new acquisitions. I just got my hands on the trade paperbacks of Body Count and the TMNT Batman Volume 2 crossover. And obviously with Batman 2, you can expect a lot of the villains of the Batman universe to be included. It looks like Bane is going to be playing a big part in this if you haven't read it already. And this Body Count... I don't even know how to begin with this one. It is certainly violent, and definitely not for the kiddos, but it looks like it's very action filled, very heavy metal esque. If you remember Kevin Eastman's involvement with the Heavy Metal magazine. It definitely has that vibe to it. So I am definitely looking forward to checking out these two comics. And I will report back hopefully in our next episode with some more details on these stories. So with that, let's get into some news.
The authorities won't talk to us, but they might talk to a TV news reporter. How do I look?
Great.
General, April O'Neil, Channel 9 News. Channel 6 News.
So, what's with the getup? You a news reporter?
In another lifetime, maybe.
This is April O'Neil, Channel 6 News.
April O'Neil, Channel 3 Eyewitness News.
This is April O'Neil, Channel 3 News.
All right, so the first bit of... we'll just do some quick news bites here. Did want to mention that... And this is interesting because it's actually coming to my neck of the woods here, but at the Orlando Science Center, the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Secrets of the Sewer exhibition is going to be coming here next year from May 25th through September 2nd of 2019. And this is the same exhibit that we've been referencing, I guess, man, it's probably been a few years as it's been making its way around the country. So it's finally coming to the Orlando area, and I've been to the Orlando Science Center multiple times. They host different exhibits, traveling exhibits. The Star Wars exhibit came through here a few years ago. So we went there, and I know my wife likes to bring our newborn. Well, I guess she's not a newborn; she's a toddler now, but I know she likes to bring the baby there. So, so this is going to be coming next year. Throughout the summer, and so definitely look forward to a on the site news report of this event, and I'll probably take some video and stuff like that and put it on the YouTube page as well. So yeah, so let's go into video game news. So it's been a little while since we've had some legitimate video game news, but legitimate. There is a new video game that's going to be coming to consoles that and PC that's going to be coming out October 23rd, I believe is still the date. And this is going to be a Nickelodeon kart racer. And that's actually going to be featuring the Turtles. So, in addition, it'll be, you know, your SpongeBob, Patrick, Sandy, all four Ninja Turtles, Arnold and Helga, Angelica, Tommy, Reptar, you know, all the, your Nickelodeon classics, I guess. I do believe this is the, previous, the 2012 Nick Turtles versions of the Turtles that are going to be in this game. You know, I really do enjoy kart racers, and I guess primarily because it's one of the games that I get to play with my wife. Because in our freshman year of college, I basically taught her to be very good at Mario Kart 64, and so good that she could actually beat me, and I was very proud of that. So occasionally we'll get a chance to play a modern kart racer, and so I think we're gonna have to try this out. That's gonna be October 23rd, PlayStation 4, Xbox One, and PC. So stand by for some updates on that. Did want to mention a couple other little things here. TMNT. So If anybody, you know, listening is a video gamer, you've definitely heard of Fortnite. If you haven't heard of it, that probably just means you don't play video games. if you've heard of it, you may have played it, considering the fact that it's actually free to play. And it's not 100% free. It's free to play the game, but you can buy upgrades, and it's all just cosmetic stuff. So you can change, you know, obviously there's all the dancing and all of the costumes, and the way the game starts, each game starts is for the Battle Royale mode is you jump out of a bus and then you skydive down and then you pull out a glider. Well, there was actually a TMNT inspired glider on Fortnite that was released. I'm not sure if it's still available because they kind of cycle through that stuff. So I'd have to double check, but I do have a picture of it in the show notes. As always, check the show notes for all links to all the stories, all the pictures and everything. And I did want to give an update on Injustice 2. I do finally have the U.S. version of the game. You can go back and listen to the fiasco that happened previously. But I've been playing it, and I'd love to be able to play with some of the listeners out there. So check out our Twitter feed and our Facebook feed for some online play opportunities. You can go ahead if you want, if you are interested, to send us a message through any of those means or via email. And just let us know that you're interested if you want to play some Injustice 2 online as the TMNT. It's a lot of fun, I gotta say. So I if you remember, I played a lot of Injustice 1, or the original Injustice. There was no 1. But it's very much a sequel, but definitely having the Turtles in there is a lot of fun. It's a lot of fun, and I want to talk about it, mention something else too. Is, you know, there's various incarnations of the Turtles available to consumers right now. And definitely designed for different age groups. I was just mentioning the body count here, and that one's definitely a for adults version of the Turtles. Injustice 2, I would say, is on par with that. You know, it's akin to Mortal Kombat. I would say, you know, in terms of the violence level and stuff, but, let's just put it this way. Raphael uses his size in this game. Let's just put it at that. I think you can kind of guess what's going on with the size. Last thing I wanted to mention in video game is, in video game news is, I wanted to see if anyone out there has seen the TMNT game, by Raw Thrills, the arcade game. If anyone has seen it out in the wild, I still haven't had a chance to play it. I've been like every 2 weeks, checking in with the, Dave and Buster's here in Orlando and still no luck. So, I think, my illustrious co-hosts, Darby and Alex are trying to find versions of the game in their respective areas throughout Florida as well. So we're still working on trying to find it. So if you found it, let us know if you've played it, what you thought of it. And with that, let's get into some. We got a lot of it. TV news. As this is being released, we've got only a few days left until the official debut of Rise of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. So the official debut, I have to say official because five of the first episodes are already online. I've watched them all. The official debut, though, is September 17th at 6:30 p.m. Interesting time for the debut there. 5:30 Central. It's an even more strange time. But, yeah, like I said, you can already watch them online. So it is interesting to see. I mean, the Star Wars Resistance, I think that's the name of it. That is debuting at 10 p.m. on Disney Channel. And that is similar to Rise. Its demographic is a younger audience. So strange time selections here. One early, one late. So, with that being said, you can head over to NECA.com/Rise of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, all with dashes there. Again, show notes. Here's a thing that just happened, on Tuesday. We have the full extended theme song now, and this is composed by Matt Mahaffey, Mahaffey, and he's an American multi-instrumentalist, multi-platform record producer, Emmy Award and Annie Award nominated composer, best known for his band Self. It's the name of his band is called Self. Mahaffey previously served as a composer for Nickelodeon's Sanjay and Craig and Disney's Henry Hugglemonster. It's fantastic. And wrote the original song Stay Home for the DreamWorks animated hit movie Shrek. I did see that on his IMDb that he had worked on Shrek, so... So in addition to creating his own music, he has toured with some acts you may have heard of, like Pink and Beck and Beyonce. So, you know, this guy's definitely got a history of some work here. So, you know, let's talk from me, and let's go ahead and give this thing a listen.
Activate music mode. Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. Go use them in our shell.
our moment.
We're gonna be heroes!
Let's do it!
Yeah! Wow. Man, I really enjoyed that longer version. I really did. I'm definitely starting to get into the mood of this series. I'm definitely don't want to spoil anything for these first episodes, but watching it, you definitely get a feel of the younger audience that it's aiming for. And it's interesting because I'm surprised I haven't heard anyone else reference this other show. But when I'm watching it, I'm really getting a Ren and Stimpy vibe from it. And maybe it's just because, you know, we're all old and stuff. We meaning me and my co-host. That show's just, I guess, not a thing anymore. It's not part of the popular culture. So, but back in my day, Ren and Stimpy was a thing, and this definitely has a lot of similar vibes that show had. So, which is interesting because even as a kid, Ren and Stimpy to me seemed too much. It was a lot of times too flashy. It was too, you know, the gross out moments, obviously the animation style. I mean, you can notice some similarities there as well. So, but even as a kid, I watched, watching Ren and Stimpy, I was like, this is a little too much. We're just Doug. I need to watch some more Doug. Check out the Rise of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles extended theme song cut here. This is part of, you can watch the video too. The video is obviously, it's got, you know, all kinds of scenes from the series. And, this is part of, Nickelodeon's hashtag Turtles Tuesday that they always release a new Nick. I guess, see, I keep wanting to call them Nick Turtles. They are technically Nick Turtles, but these are Rise Turtles. They keep releasing new Rise Turtles videos every Tuesday on YouTube. So we've got a link to the playlist in our show notes for that as well. So season 2 is already confirmed. That's definitely a good sign for this series that the executives there at Nickelodeon, Viacom, are liking what they're seeing. And you can watch, like I said, you can watch the five episodes. I think you have to have a login to watch all five. Just you log in with your TV subscriber info. If you don't have that, I know you can at least watch the first one on YouTube. They have the whole first episode on YouTube. We've got a link to Making of Rise of the TMNT from sketch to screen. I wanted to mention that comedian actor Rhys Darby, which is funny because now he's now the second Darby in Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. Rhys Darby is hilarious. I've been following him for a long time. He's from New Zealand, and his sense of humor is just it's too funny. So anyway, he's going to be playing Magic Hippo in Rise of the TMNT. So wanted to discuss some of the feedback that the show is getting. Comic book resources, CBR.com has a very interesting article where it's called Rise of the TMNT is just what the franchise needs. And so, they go into, why some of the changes were made. A lot of it is basically discussing the fact that, there was, it didn't want to just redo the same thing, and the creators, Andy and Ant, have definitely mentioned that too, because, coming off of the 2012 series so quickly, they didn't want to just kind of redo that. So in that vein, they went real far, they know they did, they purposefully, you know, wanted to make themselves distinctly different. So, this is a really good article. Rise of the TMNT star Kat Graham has a message for racist trolls. That is, bring it. I'm really starting to like this actress, Kat Graham. She's got some spunk. She's not going to just, let the trolls, impact her. So this is on bustle.com. So obviously this is all stemming from the people that have a problem with the fact that April is not white. Let's just call it what it is. And so, that's just really sad to hear. We've talked about it in the past that, that it's not, it just doesn't matter. The color of her skin doesn't matter at all. The characters is the thing that matters the most. So it's good to see that she's sticking up for herself and definitely setting a good example. We do have to mention here though, that, not all of the, criticism or not all of the feedback is positive. There is some criticism. This is a, article on hiddenremote.com. It's titled Rise of the TMNT is Blasphemy. So they break their commentary down here in a variety of different criticisms. So I just kind of wanted to run through these and mention them. So first one is the animation is unpleasant. Okay. I wouldn't call blasphemy, on something that you just don't enjoy. That's just an opinion. I mean, there's 2D and there's 3D. It's just a style. Like there's nothing, that's like going up to a Rembrandt and just saying like, yeah, I don't like this. I find it unpleasant. You know, that's not blasphemy. That's just a different design choice. The character redesigns stink. That's the second one. Okay. I'm going to go ahead and basically say C, response one. The personality switch is a horrible move. This is the third one. Basically having a problem with the fact that Leonardo and Raphael, switching, roles as the leader. And as we discussed in the past, I think that that's just a plot device that will work itself out, throughout through the show. So, I think that the author here is probably, jumping the gun a little bit here. Should mention the author is, his name's Greg O'Shalley. So, next one is, let's talk about the elephant in the room. And that is, of course, complaining about, April. And, he's basically complaining about, her skin color, which, I just don't even know how to approach that. It's just, I don't see that as a valid criticism at all. So I will give the author credit for one aspect is that he does reference Mark Pellegrini's TMNT Entity website, which of course we've referenced several times on the show, and in specifically an article that Mark had written back in February of this year, which was entitled, Was April O'Neil Originally Black in the Mirage Comics? And he says, spoiler, no, she wasn't. So, and basically this article goes through all the different iterations of April, in the Mirage series and how in one issue, she was, and others she wasn't, some she had, curly hair and some she had straight hair. If you ask, so let's see, he references the autobiography book that Kevin Eastman had put out in 2002. And in it, he says, this is Kevin, a quote from his book. He says, originally created as an Asian character in Pete's notes, but named after an African-American woman I once knew, the character of April O'Neil was introduced in issue 2 and would have a bunch of different looks throughout the TMNT history. So he also includes a section of Ask Peter from, let's see, 2009, where Peter Laird was asked a question on the subject. And his response is, it depends on which co-creator of the TMNT you ask. If you ask me, I always saw April O'Neil as white. If you ask Kevin, I suspect he would say, as he has in a number of interviews, that she was of mixed race, much like that of his former girlfriend, then wife, then ex-wife. So, so basically what I'm getting at here is that it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter so much that April herself has changed races throughout the history of TMNT. So the fact that her race has changed once again, it doesn't matter. It just doesn't matter. So let's just all move along and let's put this one to bed. A brand new article just came out on sci-fi.com. And this is a Rise of the TMNT creators reveal concept art and new vision. So they talk about the show, they talk about the series. They actually do include some concept art, which is pretty interesting. I'd say probably Donatello looks the most different. One thing to note is that Michelangelo does have his nunchucks while Raph has the tonfas. Leo does have the one sword, and Donatello still has his bow staff. So, and it's like a normal bow staff. It's not like a super tech one, but, yeah, it's pretty cool to see some of this concept art. I did want to bring up two little things here. Andy, he mentions that, we're both referencing a lot of lesser known French comics and things like that from the 60s and 70s in terms of inspiration. And he also says, as a designer, I look at shapes a lot. So it was deciding Raph would be the square. Donnie's personality lends itself to be a rectangle. Leo is the triangle and Mikey is the circle. So I'm going to try to keep that in mind. I'm going to try to look for, you know, design references to that. So Raph the square, Donnie the rectangle, Leo the triangle, and Mikey the circle. I'll mention really quick, we've got a bunch of links in our show notes to some of the VR experience at San Diego Comic-Con. So if you haven't seen any videos of this, you can check out these different links. It's pretty cool what they did there. So it kind of flew under the radar online, though. So so check that out. I also want to mention that the TMNT are finally going to be included in Season 3 of The Toys That Made Us. It's a fantastic series on Netflix. And the 2012 TMNT series is an underrated gem by Greg Katzman. This is also over at comicbookresources.com. I'll just go ahead and let you guys take a look at that article. And lastly, and I guess this falls under TV, it kind of falls under collecting as well, but so we'll use this as a segue here. So if you hadn't seen, Dark Horse and Nickelodeon are going to be teaming up to present The Art of Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, where producer Ciro Nieli curates a behind-the-scenes look at the 2012 animated series. It's going to be coming April 16th, 2019. It is curated and written by Ciro. Serves as a definitive guide to the 2012 Nickelodeon CG animated TV series. The 184-page hardcover will retail for $40 and features exclusive art from all five seasons, along with insider commentary and an introduction by Kevin Eastman. So I'm definitely picking this up. So with that, let's get into collecting news.
From Playmates!
So has anyone been over to a Sonic drive-in lately? Because right now they're running their Rise of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles promotion. You can pick up a little Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles action figure. It's not really an action figure. It's a little toy. It's part of the Sonic Wacky Pack. Hold on. That seems like it needs a little
Booyakasha!
No, not that one. Let's try Sonic.
Wacky Pack.
Yeah, that's better. So check that out. Sonic Drive-In. I think there's a couple in Orlando. Wanted to mention this. I came across this. There's a couple of different companies, organizations, I don't know what you want to call these, that are making 1990 TMNT film accurate costumes. I found a couple of them. One's called Prop Shop. You can go to the propshopsite.com or go to facebook.com/thepropshopsite. Another one is called Prop Shop Garage. And that's facebook.com/, well, I'll just do a search for Prop Shop Garage on Facebook. But obviously these are not official releases by any means, but some of it's not too bad. So, you know, because this thing where you're seeing, you know, people in 1990 era turtle costumes, you know, walking around in... I guess these are the options that they're going with. So check those out if you're interested. Wanted to mention the Mondo Gallery. They had their display of TMNT art. You can go on the we got the link if you want to check out the artwork that they had. New strategy for Playmates TMNT figure distribution. So I definitely had to mention this. So. It's interesting to see Playmates now adjusting with the times. Obviously, the loss of Toys R Us is probably playing a big part into this, but they are definitely highlighting a few options for you know, as opposed to a wide distribution. They're definitely focusing in on just a few outlets. So basically Target, Amazon, Walmart, and comic shop. You can just get in a comic shop. So you can go to comicshoplocator.com and find some options there. But they're specifically highlighting these four options for finding the Playmates Rise of the TMNT figures. So this is interesting to see. Specifically, Amazon. I think they sent out a tweet. I think it was the Playmates site, or maybe it was the TMNT account. But either way, and it basically said, you know, go on Amazon and buy these, which I think is really interesting to see that, you know, I guess we could call it a major distributor, like. Specifically going the online route through Amazon as opposed to going the brick and mortar route. Now, obviously, Target and Walmart have their online portions as well, but I think that they're really focusing on that online aspect, as opposed to, you know, the old school traditional, searching for figures, store to store, back in the old days. So, one to mention, so along those lines as well, you can actually get the Epic Lair playset. You can pre-order that now. Pre-ordering TMNT toys. It's such a foreign concept to me, but yeah, so the Epic Sewer Lair is now available for pre-order. 43 inches tall. It says 20 plus features. I don't know what a feature is, but but yeah, so Amazon, Walmart, Target, and yeah, they're really focusing on these. Yeah, looks like $10.99 for the standard figures. Their version of the turtle van is at $45 right now on Amazon, and the sewer lair or epic lair playset is listed at $150 right now. So. If anybody decides to go for any of these action figures, let me know. I'll probably end up getting the Raph just because I have every Raph that there is. So, speaking of big news on the collecting front, the whole San Diego Comic-Con NECA kerfuffle. I don't want to, you know, bring it all up again, but basically, we've now got a way out. Whatever has gone on behind the scenes, I don't know what happened, but somehow NECA has gotten approval from Nickelodeon Viacom, and I guess from Playmates, because they are basically, I assume they've given the okay for this, but NECA, 1990 NECA TMNT are now going to be available at GameStop, both brick and mortar and online. They are $23 each or $92 for the bundle. That's 23 times 4. And did I pre-order all of them? Yeah, you're damn right I did. So these are going to be arriving, I think, in February. I think the only difference, February 4th is the release date. And the only difference between these and the San Diego versions are it doesn't have some of the accessories. So I think the NECA ones had all kinds of little extra accessories, but it's fine. I don't display my figures with all the accessories anyway, so that is fine by me. So I am very excited to be able to get my hands on these bad boys. This was one. I mean, you know, the NECA has just come out with some amazing figures in the past few years for the Comic Cons. Whether it's the go all the way back, and there was the Mirage Turtles, and then there was the arcade game Turtles, and then there was the arcade game villains, right? Then they have the arcade game. No, they had Mirage villains, and then these ones. And I mean, obviously, everybody knows where the 1990 film sits with me, so. This was the one where I just really felt like, you know, if I can get my hands on these, I definitely want these. But, you know, they were selling out online in a matter of less than a minute. So, and I live on the other side of the continent from San Diego. So, but anyway, you can head over to GameStop.com. We've got a link in the show notes if to go right to it. And let us know if you grab these turtles as well. So. One last thing I wanted to mention here that, I guess another segue, the amazing Mateus Santoloco, has, a sale of his original IDW TMNT artwork, right now, 50% off. It's cadencecomicart.com, or check our link for the show notes, to go directly to this sale. And, yeah, if you've got some cash that you want to, throw down on some of this artwork, it's the real deal. The real artwork that was used, for the IDW, comic. So, a variety of prices depending on the scene, depending on what's going on on the page. Looks like the cheapest I'm seeing right now is $75, but it goes all the way up to $325. For like the cover. So, and that's half off. okay. I see, do see one here for $65. So I think that's the cheapest one I see right now. So yeah, so that's that, that $325 is half off of the standard price. So, if you are interested in getting yourself some original comic book art, for the Turtles, now is the time. With that, let's get into comics news.
I strike two on my way down. Donatello takes out a third with his staff. Already the pudgy ones are starting to panic. Raph loves this stuff. He's not alone.
Why is he narrating? Is he crazy?
Hardcore crazy.
I love these guys!
So quickly, I'll mention that Amazon and Comixology are doing their TMNT sale right now. They do this sale a couple times every year, but this is the time where if you've got a backlog and you want to catch up, this would be the time to do it. So check that out. Jason Latour, he's a departing writer, artist for Spider-Gwen, and he sent out a tweet that says, I promised all the Spider-Gwen fans a parting gift, and well, I don't write Gwen for real anymore, so this is fan fiction. Hope you all enjoy it. Cowabunga, my dudes and dudettes. And it's basically, it's a short mini comic of Spider-Gwen crossing over with the TMNT. So it's cute. It's a little short little thing, but it's nice. I do want to mention Shredder in Hell coming in 2019. I think it's January. But basically, this is going to be a sequel to the Secret History of the Foot Clan by the incomparable Matteo Santoloco. 5-issue miniseries. What can I say about the Secret History of the Foot Clan? That is an amazing, amazing trade paperback. And this one, if this is going to be in that same vein, it's going to be amazing as well. So I'll just read this. This is a quote from Mateus. He says, "We're not only revealing Shredder's role in a conspiracy of divine proportions, but we'll have a better understanding of his fears and ambitions. Hiroko Saki is more human than ever, and this will only make him an even stronger force for the TMNT to face." Now, I don't think that that's any sort of a spoiler or anything, because this is what the Shredder does. He always comes back. Every version of Turtles, they defeat the Shredder, and then eventually he figures out a way to come back and seek revenge. So definitely looking forward to this release here. I think we mentioned Macro Series 1 in our last episode. That's the Donatello and September 26 on that. But we do have dates for the others. So Michelangelo's is going to, number 2 is going to be October 10th. Leonardo number 3 at November 21st. And we do have confirmation from Ben Bishop that he is working on number 4, Raphael, subtitled Target R. This is going to be coming out in December, and it is going to be featuring Alopex as well. So with that, let's get into the release schedule. IDW main series 85 is out now. 86 is September 19th, 87 October 24th. The final TMNT Universe issue, number 25, that concludes the miniseries there, that is out now. Bebop and Rocksteady Hit the Road, that is the miniseries that came out last month. All 5 issues are out now. Rise of the TMNT, Double Zero is out now. Number 1 available September 19th. Number 2 available October 17th. And there's that Halloween mini comic that's going to be coming out in October as well. I think there's an early release on October 3rd, and I think maybe officially releasing October 27th. Just check with your local comic shop on that one. For the Mirage front, Volume 7, the Ultimate Collection, is going to be coming out January 2nd, 2019. I do have that pre-ordered. That is all of the covers from the Mirage days, and there's some other stuff included in there as well. This basically is replacing that that covers collection that was originally announced and then canceled. So makes sense to include it as part of the Ultimate Collection. And then Tales of the TMNT, the original Mirage Tales of the TMNT Volume 2, the IDW release of that in a collected form, Volume 8 is out now. Which is Tales issues 22 through 25. Volume 9, which will be issues 26 through 30, is currently delayed without a new release date, so stay tuned. Image Turtles, so the original Volume 3, which is now being re-released as Urban Legends. Number 5 is out now. Number 6 is coming October 17th. And if you don't remember, this is the 23-issue release of the original Volume 3. These are all colored pages now. And there will be a final 3-issue story arc to officially conclude the volume as well at the end of the original 23. And Body Count Collected, I mentioned that earlier, that is out now as well. On the DC front, Batman TMNT Crossover Volume 2, just got that one as well, mentioned that earlier. Dark Horse, Usagi Yojimbo, TMNT The Complete Collection, trade paperback releasing October 9th. I do have that pre-ordered as well. The Aardvark Vanheim, Teenage Mutant Ninja Cerebine, number one, is out now. And on the Archie front, the final Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Adventures Volume 16 trade paperback from IDW collects Archie TMNT Adventures issues 67 through 72, available November 28th, 2018. So this will conclude the entire Archie run in a collected form, and which is fantastic. The only thing that's missing is there was some of those seasonal issues. The Mighty Mutanimals. I think there's some April issues, some April spinoff issues as well. So it'll be interesting to see if they end up reprinting those as well, or if they'll just end it with 72. So I did want to mention this as well. If you have a library card for your county or your city or whatever, check with your library to see if they participate in any apps. So in Orange County here in Florida, they have several apps that they use. So basically you open the app, you log in with your library card, and then you can download ebooks and audiobooks. And there's one app in particular called Hoopla that the library here in Orange County participates with. And so you log in, and of course, first thing I'm doing is looking for Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. And lo and behold, there are a ton of Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles comics included in this app. I've got obviously digital versions, but a lot of the Archie are included in there as well. So I think that's how I'm going to go back and read these, because with the Archie and going back into my old days, I've only got a handful of the hard copies. I have quite a few of the 72, but there's a lot of individual issues missing in between. So rather than trying to find those individual issues, I think I'm just going to check out the app here and see how that goes. So
sounds weird when he says it.
Sounds weird when you say it.
Let's finish off some mutated messages here. On the 1990 film commentary route here, we've got a comment from Sawyer Family Reviews that says, that this is James from TMNTfilm.com here that did the actual audio rip. Yes, he did. And we definitely, he says, just discovered this being here. Appreciate the shout out, guys. Yes, you're welcome, James. We, if you haven't listened to it yet, I give a little intro, and I do give a shout out to TMNTfilm.com as they did provide the original rip. So, Brave or Grave says, oh my God, thanks so much for this. And then, Kellen O'Rourke asked, is there any way of getting the DVD? And yeah, they're basically what you do is, go to the German version of Amazon. Just Google Germany Amazon, and it's like Amazon.de, I think, for Deutschland. And, so you basically pull that up and, just do a search for Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, in the Blu-ray DVD section, because you can get the DVD or the Blu-ray. The Blu-ray has the commentary on it as well. And, and they do ship to the U.S. Obviously it's going to be more expensive, but, they will ship to the U.S. from there. So if you're interested in actually getting a copy of it for yourself, one of our listeners, Dave, sent in, some photos. He had a chance to check out the IDW comic art gallery out in, San Diego, at the IDW campus. And, so some really cool photos of, Kevin's office and, the giant Raphael figurine that they have there. As far as a follow-up on the Raphael as the leader discussion that we had in our last episode, Be Sensible Please says, that's just my point. If Raphael still has emotional issues, then it's a roadblock. Second, Raphael does have leadership qualities, at least the ones before 2012 and 2013, where he actually learns to face and cope with his own issues. Image Raph actually put aside his problems to take up the mantle of Shredder and lead the Foot Clan for a short while before being overtaken. I don't know if that's a good example of him being a good leader, but he also says, and it's fairly obvious that he can't be any sort of leader while he struggles in a state of anger. That's true. But with Rise of the TMNT Raphael, his character was changed to being a meathead rather than angry, so that he'll be replaced. So the potential leadership was thrown out the window. Our longtime listener, Sal Otero, he's got some new videos up on YouTube definitely recommend. He's got a cool one with Scorpion crossed with Shredder. And then he's got one where he's got the Turtles versus the Battletoads and Double Dragons. That one's really cool. I think he just did a Mikey one as well. So we got some links in the show notes to that as well. So with that, let's get into our interview with our very special guest. Without further ado, our special guest on the Turtle Power Podcast. We've been talking about this show basically since it came out, and we've got the let's call it the main host. I think that's safe to say. But
well, that's generous.
Yeah, well, we got to do a proper intro here.
Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's Scott Tofte from TMNT Minute.
Ladies and gentlemen, Major League Butt Kicking is back in town. Oh, hey, man. Thanks for having me on. I'm super excited to do this.
Oh, it's my pleasure. You know, as soon as I came across your show, I said, you know, this is something I'm going to enjoy just because, you know, this film is just so universally adored by all Turtles fans, but I didn't realize how much more of an appreciation of that film that I was going to have while listening to your show. So,
I mean, that's kind of our goal. I mean, we came into this movies by minute thing. There's like a whole community of these podcasts out there. It started with the guys over at Star Wars Minute, and they were doing this for a while. They did like, you know, I think I don't know if they started with the prequels or started with the original series, but they were doing 1 minute at a time. And then like my buddy Scott, our producer, was one of the early guys to jump in. He did Back to the Future Minute. And then all of a sudden it was like, there's a billion of them, like literally any movie you could think of. And we got lucky that, you know, no one had taken Ninja Turtles yet. I was like, you know, this is a movie I grew up loving. It's not just a kid's movie. I think there's a lot of people out there that really like this film as just that, as a film, not just as a nostalgia trip.
Totally.
And I think there's a lot of stuff we could really talk about in this format. So,
so
we had a blast doing it.
So, oh, it is a blast listening to it.
Glad you enjoyed it.
So describe the, for anyone who hasn't taken our advice and listened, could you, I mean, it's TMNT Minute, so you can kind of guess, but do you want to go through like the premise of the show, how it works?
Yeah, so it's a Movies by Minute podcast. If you look, you know, hashtag MXM or Movies by Minute on Twitter or Instagram or anything, you'll find a bunch of them. But ours is Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Minute, and what we do is we do a daily show Monday through Friday, or we did while we were doing this. We're gearing up for season two now, but it's a daily show. It comes out
right
Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and every day we discuss for, you know, an episode, which is usually between 15 and 30 minutes. We discuss 1 minute of the 1990 Ninja Turtles film. So like the first minute of the movie is, you know, a shot of New York City, the New Line Cinema logo. And we literally talk about just the stuff in that minute. You know, we did a spiel on like the history of New Line Cinema and Golden Harvest Productions. And we literally at the end of the movie, we read every single credit. You know, and
yeah,
anything interesting, yeah, we talked about it. Now some of the stuff is a little mundane. Not everything is gold. You know, you have like 93 minutes or whatever to get through here. There's going to be some more interesting minutes than others. But if you subscribe to the show, if you're looking for a podcast that's going to take up a fair amount of your time to listen to, I highly recommend ours if you're a Turtles fan. It's really, really entertaining. And, you know, you guys do a great job. There's other fantastic Turtle podcasts out there that sort of cover the fandom. But the thing I enjoyed about ours is we had like a very specific mission.
Yeah, absolutely. You know? Absolutely.
And those confines, the box that we put ourselves in sort of gave us a really good it allowed us to really get creative with the content that we were putting out there without stepping on other people's toes, which is nice too.
There was a lot of creativity going into it for sure. we'll talk about that in a little bit. I did want to point that out too, that, in those slower moments, someone who hasn't listened might think like, oh, they're just going to kind of meander there for the minute. But you guys didn't do
sometimes
that.
Sometimes we do.
Well, I mean,
get a little meandery.
Yeah. Well, I mean, but I guess you did the best you can with what you had, because you did go into the history of New Line, and, it's, you know, the film's production, history, back, in, was it Chinese, right?
Yeah, so yep. It was originally Golden Harvest was like a and this is stuff I learned doing the podcast. It's not stuff I came to this show knowing. Golden Harvest was mainly a producer of like Chinese like martial arts films. They had done a whole I can't even remember the names of some of them, but one of them was like an Irish American like ninja police officer. so they had all these sort of like B martial art movies, and somehow they acquired the rights to make this Ninja Turtles movie. So it really is like it's like a Hong Kong action flick.
Right. Right. Yeah. Yeah.
Directed by a British director, released for primarily American audiences.
It's a, it's an international affair.
It's a global affair.
so let's see, we talked about the premise of the show.
I should mention, you know, I'm not the only one there. We have three other fantastic hosts.
Let's talk about Adam, your co-host. Yeah.
And, Adam and Rachel and Chris, who are buddies of mine for a long time now. We've done a bunch of shows together. Chris and Rachel and I started doing this show. We were acting on the show called Geek by Night, which our network, Dueling Genre Productions, mm-hmm. put out. And you know, we met on that. We've done a couple other podcasts together, and Adam is Rachel's boyfriend. He was a huge Turtles fan. So when I tossed this to her, about doing this Ninja Turtles show, he's like, oh my God, can I do this too? We were like, absolutely. And you know, we thought, what a perfect way to do a podcast about four Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles is to have four hosts.
Yeah.
Absolutely. It never once got too crowded, or, you know, we never ever talked over each other.
It's true. It's very true.
I didn't ever have to spend hours editing crosstalk.
your chemistry was phenomenal. I mean, it really was.
Everyone brings something super cool to the show, which is really helpful. Chris is a military kid. So he grew up, you know, traveling around the world. He was in Germany when Turtles got started, like the cartoons started getting big, but he knows all this stuff about warfare and combat and weapons, and he studied martial arts, so he's got this cool perspective.
That was a very totally.
Yeah, Adam is big into, you know, the new comic books and, you know, the video games and sort of that aspect of it. I come from more like the TV show and the Mirage comics. And then Rachel is someone who's like, she had the TV show, plus she's the girl. Like, not to say that we have a token female host, but you know, we have a female host, and unfortunately in the 90s, you know, girls who were into Turtles always got kind of relegated into the April O'Neil role mm-hmm. when they're playing with their friends. So it was interesting to have someone with that perspective and bring that point of view that we didn't have.
It was that perspective. Yep.
And it makes for a really interesting, and everyone has their own ideas about like what happens behind the scenes. And there's some crazy stuff, some cool fan theories we threw out there, but, The co-hosts on the show are unbelievable. I cannot stress enough how integral they are to the success of the show.
So you mentioned you guys are going to be coming back for a season two. Are we talking the 1991 Secret of the Ooze?
We are. Yeah, we're doing Secret of the Ooze Minute. Fantastic. It's officially announced, but we really haven't gotten moving on it too much yet. You know, we know we want to do it. We have a platform to do it. We have a lot of people that want us to do it. It's just a matter of getting everyone's day jobs to line up so that we can do it.
Oh, yeah.
But it's very much coming. We hope to get it started before the end of the year. And, you know, knock on wood, we'll have episodes coming out after New Year's.
Yes.
Don't hold me to that, though.
No. As a fellow podcaster, I know that scheduling is the hardest thing to do.
Oh my God. Well, how long have we been trying to get, you know, this crossover episode happening?
Sure. And my two co-hosts aren't even here. So,
I know. Hi, like guys. Sorry, you couldn't make it.
And your co-hosts aren't here. Hi, guys.
I know.
So,
is like our solo album. You know, the band breaks up, but we're like, we're gonna go do our own thing now.
Because you're a musician, so.
Yeah, I am.
It's a, we'll call it a, it's one of the supergroups, right? We'll
there just, we go. There. That's what it is. Yeah, we're like Asia.
Just like Asia.
We're just like Asia.
Just like Asia.
This is basically just Asia.
Basically just Asia. That's the title of this episode.
You're welcome.
And so you guys did have some additional co-hosts that would come in at like a week at a time too, right? You guys would have some.
Oh my God. We had – I wish I should have pulled up the list, but we had so many. We had this minutes – movies by minute – podcasting community is all really close knit. They have a convention that they've done for 2 years in a row now.
Wow.
We haven't been able to make it to it, but we sort of all guest on each other's shows. You know, Scott Carelli from Back to the Future Minute, from Spider-Man Minute, was on our show. He's, you know, again, he's the guy that runs Dueling Genre, our network.
Yep.
He kind of is the quote producer of our show, which means that he pays for the website. we had people from, you know, Return to Oz Minute. And we had people from, oh man, what else? Like Titanic Minute. We had Ralph from the TV show Cake Boss on
our
show.
That's right, you did.
We had some really cool guests. We got, the TURTLE Power song at the end of the movie is done by a group called Partners in Crime. And we had Rich from Partners in Crime on our show. We interviewed him and he sat in for a minute or two.
I felt really bad because he reached out to me like years ago and I totally missed his message and I found it a year later. And then I felt bad to,
you should reach out to him. Cause he's a super nice guy. We actually were talking music stuff, afterwards and we've been in touch on and off. He's a really, really good guy. And you know, he does some great work in his community and he's always trying to do more music stuff. And he's super good to the TMNT like fan community. He shows up all the time at conventions he and Vanilla Ice occasionally do shows together.
Yes. Well, you guys, I mean, your interview with him was fantastic. And I honestly don't know if we could do a better one. And
he was so much fun. He had so many cool things to say. So that was like at minute 80 something of our show. I think I can't even remember now. That's definitely one worth checking out. We had the extreme pleasure. I shot a bunch of messages out on Twitter. Twitter is great for some things, not great for everything, but great for some everything. Things.
Yeah. Very true.
But I shot a bunch of messages out to members of the cast, the crew, and you know, we got a couple back, and the really good one that we got back was the director of the movie, Steve Barron, was actually like, hey, I'll come on. I'll talk to you guys. So we were like, I was freaking out when we got that tweet back. You know, Steve Barron, this guy directed the movie. He did the Michael Jackson Billie Jean video. He did the Aha video. He's like a legend to me. You know, as a musician and a Turtles fan, this is like a great 1-2 punch of a guest. He reached out to us, and it was around Christmas time of last year. And I traveled, you know, I live in New York City. I traveled upstate to near Syracuse, to my parents' house, and I have a laptop and a USB mic, and that's all I have. I don't have any of my other fancy podcasting equipment that I have here in my home studio. And I'm trying to do this Skype interview with me, my three hosts, one of whom is on a cell phone, I think, and I'm trying to record his audio. And then Steve Barron, who is also, I think, on a cell phone recording his audio, like with his voice recorder app.
Wow.
And the internet is crapping out the whole interview. I felt so bad. Like it's my one regret about doing this show is like, I wish I could have scheduled that interview better just to be in a place where the internet was better, because we really did struggle trying to get, a fluid conversation going. But I would say, even with all the technical difficulties that we experienced, he was super patient. He was super forthcoming about information. He told some great stories, and it ended up being a pretty good interview.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, yeah, you guys edited it really good too. And it really was fascinating to listen to, because I mean, aside from the commentary that's on the German DVD, have you heard that? Have you heard the?
You know, he mentioned that he did that commentary, and I still haven't heard it. I need to find that somewhere because I'm dying to listen to it.
We have it on our YouTube channel. So
I'll
send you a link when we're done.
Please do.
And that was like the only outlet that we had for his analysis of the film. And so your interview, I mean, it basically, you know, it was a whole new set of information. So,
I feel that I'm getting goosebumps. I feel so important now.
Yeah. That night, that
look, we did a service to the community.
You
look
did.
At us.
Absolutely did. Absolutely did.
No, he was a super nice guy too. It was awesome to hear all his stories about Jim Henson and, you know, working with the puppets and things like that. Yes. That was super cool.
Yeah.
I'm a huge Muppets fan too. So like, sure. How do you not love that stuff?
Yeah, absolutely. And of course you, you had Kevin on, recently.
We just had, I forgot about that. We just had Kevin Eastman on, you know, we've been doing these random, like every once in a while shows during our hiatus. We did one when they announced Rise of the TMNT. We've put out a couple commentaries from when we all got together in Philly and got a little drunk.
Yes.
But we just recently, Kevin Eastman was doing some press for Comic-Con, and he was like, you know, I had shot him a random email months ago and completely forgot about it. Figured like he's not interested. I'm not going to bug him. Totally cool. He's a busy guy. He's got a lot going on. His wife, who I guess is his manager, reached out and was like, you know, Kevin's going to be doing a bunch of press days. We can give you a 20-minute slot on this day or this day. And I was like, oh, my God. So I immediately jump. We communicate on Facebook Messenger because we're old. I jump on Facebook Messenger to my crew and I'm like, guys, you're never going to guess. We just booked Kevin Eastman. It's going to happen. And again, I am at home. It was another holiday. I had gone up to my parents' house in Syracuse. Chris is calling in from his cell phone again, and we're just going, this is going to be a nightmare. It's going to be the same thing as Steve Barron all over again. We're going to have this internet problem. It's not going to work. We're going to blow this, and we're nervous. We're so nervous. Not only that, but the list of people in my parents' house that weekend, my parents, my sister and her husband and her kid, my brother, his wife, their three teenagers who all have devices on the Wi-Fi. Me. Oh my, like, it's just this huge crew of people. There's like 9 people in my parents' house all like trying to check their Facebook. So I was like, guys, look, this is the biggest, you know, Turtles related interview that I think I can possibly do. I don't think there's a bigger one than this. Like, I don't know what it would be, right?
Yeah, Kevin's,
like, Peter Laird would be, sure. If I can get Kevin and Peter together, that would be amazing. Well, but that, Kevin's like, that's like it, right?
Sure. Yeah.
So I tell my parents and my family, I'm like, you guys, you know what? You have to leave. You have to go to dinner, something. You can't be – I need all the bandwidth I can get for this interview. And thank God it went off without a hitch. And again, you know, it was a short interview, but I think it was a really good interview with Kevin.
Yeah, it absolutely
another
was.
Super nice dude. Like all the people in the Turtles like world are so nice.
Yeah. We've had the absolute pleasure of having Kevin on our show 3 times. Courtney's amazing. I mean, she
seems super nice too. She was very awesome in her email communications.
Yes.
Very polite, very respectful.
She's great.
With no reason to be as nice as they are. Like, they could totally be like Hollywood snobs, but they're not at all. They're great people.
They are amazing. It's, you know, I don't know if there's something, you know, where, you know, just the way that they are, and that is serves as an example to the community to be like, hey, you know, this is how you should be. This, you should be cool people, you know?
Like, well, it's like they embody what the Turtles represent. You know, I think every – it's one of the things – I'm going to get a little bit of a, you know, get off my lawn here for a minute. But one of the things that I think is missing in a lot of sort of media for kids nowadays, like a lot of these action shows that kids watch, is sort of the moral compass.
Mm.
And I think the Turtles, as cheesy as that cartoon was – you know, it had a distinct moral compass. You know, you knew that the Turtles were the good guys.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, the movie, like even the comic books, everything sort of has this sort of like moral center that is kind of really refreshing and that people, I think, my age really identify with. You know, we joined martial arts and we started taking karate as kids because we wanted to be like the Turtles. We wanted to be heroes. We wanted to like help people and fight bad guys. It wasn't like a, you know, Cobra Kai kind of, I want to be a, you know, tough guy kind of thing. And you know, Power Rangers was kind of the same way. But Kevin totally embodies that. He's like super zen and like positive and like helpful and like loves his fans. It's really a cool experience to get to talk to him. I'm still pinching myself. Like I'm sitting here looking at my collection of Ninja Turtle toys on my shelf, which is not nearly as big as it used to be anymore. Thinking like, holy cow, I have talked to the guy that is responsible for all this stuff now.
Well, in a similar fashion with Steve Barron, where his insight into the film. You got a lot of insight into the film from Kevin, which, I mean, you know, because when we talk to him, we're, you know, because we're across the entire franchise, we're talking about everything. So, but it was fantastic to hear him dive into the subject of the 90 film, you know,
where, yeah. And you know, that was premeditated because we were told, you know, you're going to have 20 minutes in court. He was like, try not to go over. Kevin will go over, try to keep him to 20 minutes.
Yeah.
Because we've got other interviews. Sure. So yeah. I'm like, okay, we've got 20 minutes. We're a Turtles movie podcast. Like, we should really try to focus primarily on his experiences with the film. Because, like, he's, you know, he's given interviews. He's always giving interviews. He's really nice like that. But I didn't want to get information that I already knew or that I'd already heard. You know, he hasn't really talked a ton about the film in sort of, like, popular media.
Yeah, sure.
So that was kind of my goal, was to keep it as movie centric as possible. And then we asked him his favorite pizza also.
He did. And so obviously you have to get him back after Secret of the Ooze.
I hope we can. I really, really want to. Yeah. There's still a bunch of people I wanted to get. You know, I reached out to Judith Hogue. I wanted to get her on the show. And at some point she tweeted back to me, like, you know, hit me up. And I hit her up and then I never heard back again. Yeah. So again, people get busy. Sure. I realize we're like a lowly little independent podcast,
but
there's a whole bunch of people for Turtles too that we want to try to get, you know, from cast and crew, but then also other podcasters, other fans of the show who haven't had a chance to get on with season one. When we did TMNT 90, we have this great Facebook fan group, Teenage Mutant or TMNT Minute listeners group on Facebook. And the interaction in that group, everyone is so cool. They're really nice to each other. We have great conversations. People are like, the podcast has been over for months now and people are still posting stuff into that page, like sharing. We've built a little, you know, nice, small, but tight little community there.
It's an evergreen show though. I mean, that's what's fantastic about it too, is that anybody can jump in right now and listen.
That's the beautiful part of these movies by minute things, is like, you can literally, there's no timestamp on it. Like, yes, some of the jokes we make will be a little dated in a few years. I remember we started the show and we were like, oh my God, the world is a terrible place. It can't get much worse. And then like 3 months later, we actually, like, that was our pilot episode. And by the time we dropped our first real episode, we're like, wow, we were wrong. So, you know, some of that stuff is a little dated, but for the most part, it holds up pretty nicely, I think.
It does.
I think it's a well-made show, too. I also, you know, being a musician and, you know, a freelance audio engineer, I like to think that, you know, a lot of care goes into the sound of our show, making sure that you can hear everything properly. You know, that music that you hear at the beginning, I could not get my hands on a copy of the Turtle soundtrack. I couldn't do it. I wanted to use that theme music, you know, a snippet of it for the intro. I couldn't find it. So I recreated it in GarageBand from scratch.
Oh, did you?
Yeah.
Oh yeah. I guess you did. Yeah. Yeah. It's funny because I've listened to your intro theme song so much that has kind of replaced the, the actual one. But now that we just played this one, I was like, oh yeah, it is a little different. Look at that.
I also want to reiterate, I make no money off that podcast, so please nobody sue me.
Yeah, well, neither do we, so yeah, we'd be in big trouble.
Yeah, that's another way. If I could get John Duprez on our show, oh my God.
Yes.
The music for this movie in particular is so perfect. I think at one point in the show, I said something to the effect of, like, Princess Bride, the music in Princess Bride. Are you familiar?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So Mark Knopfler does this incredible soundtrack to Princess Bride, but it's, you know, it's very stylized. It's very kind of almost sounds like MIDI instruments, like 80s computer generated instrumentation meant to sound like, you know, Renaissance or classical music.
Yep.
But it works. It works so perfectly for that particular film. And John Duprez did the same thing. He made a score that utilizes sounds and textures that would not work in any other time period for any other movie. It is so specific to this series of films, but it's so good. And he almost didn't have the job, which we also learned from Steve Barron.
Yeah, yeah, that's right. Yeah, that score, it not being released is it's a shame. I mean, it really is.
Look, I understand that they can't do like the Blu-ray special edition with bonus scenes and all that stuff, because that stuff is just
that was so hard to listen to him talk about.
But can we, like, I just want the John Duprez score. I just want that so bad. Like, I had the soundtrack on cassette tape with all the songs, sure, with the MC Hammer and all that stuff. But oh, I want that score so bad.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
It's a crime that it wasn't ever put out.
Yeah. I mean, it was, I guess, a sign of the times, you know, like, you know.
Oh, sure. I mean, first off, no one knew if that movie was going to make any money. Why bother putting it out, you know?
Sure.
It was made for something like $13 million, and, like, it was a throwaway. No one thought it was going to do anything.
It's true.
And it was the biggest selling independent movie of all time at that point.
That's true. Let's
and in my opinion, still, it's the best Turtles movie. I don't like, look, Michael Bay and yada yada yada. I think this movie is the best. I think it's the best version of Turtles, period.
Yeah.
Out of anything, out of the comic books, I think this particular movie really nailed exactly what the Turtles is about. And I think that's one of the reasons why all four of our the hosts on the show were so interested in doing this movie, because we all kind of feel the same about that.
Yeah. I mean, it's got everything, you know. It's got the heart, it's got the action. You know, we were talking about earlier with the moral center, you know.
Yeah.
It has everything, and you know, you top it off with that unique sound and the score. I mean, no one has ever listened to that score and said, I have no idea what movie this is from.
Yeah, right?
It is so unique, but it's so fantastic. Let me transition, because we mentioned it earlier. One thing that's unique about your show are some of the fan theories, or film theories. Let's
call
it
that. Oh, my God.
So we got to mention these, and I'm so glad that you brought them up to Kevin. Or was it Kevin, or was it Steve? I think it was Kevin.
Oh, I bring them up to everybody.
Yeah. I was bringing them
I
up.
I get a lot of flack for that.
No. I love it. I love it. Especially with
my co-hosts, like, are kind of over it by this point. But I needed to get people's opinions on them.
I think it's fantastic, especially with a character like Danny, where there's nothing else. You know, there's nothing else about this character. So why not? You know, there's nothing to contend against.
Yeah.
You know?
Oh, so you're talking about the one. OK, I'll give you this, and then I'll tell you this one for your audience. And then it's sort of a tease to get them to listen to my show. I'll tell them that there is another one involving Casey Jones as well.
Yes, there is.
But and that's the one I get a little darker crap for. So the theory that we had with Danny is like, okay, Danny is sort of out of place in this movie. Charles is a character that we've never really seen before. They're both sort of invented for this film. And like, I kind of understand Charles as, you know, he's the sort of the opposite of April, like what she's he is her conflict in this film. So the thing that she has to overcome. Right.
Right.
Danny was to me for the longest time was always just sort of there. And like, he doesn't have a lot of lines. He doesn't really do much. Now, I have since discovered his value in this film, and my opinion on him has changed. But I came into this movie being like, dude, I hate Danny. He sucks. bad character. Don't like him. We came up with this theory, like, you know, it's funny. He, like, why does Charles bring Danny to April's apartment? That's weird.
It is weird.
Like, why is the boss bringing his kid to his employee's apartment?
Yeah.
Very strange.
It's very strange.
Also, why is Danny like a ginger? He's like a redhead, but April's kind of like a redhead.
She
Charles is.
Is
bald, looks nothing like. Oh my God. Is Danny. Is that April's kid? Did Charles and April have a kid? And like, Danny doesn't know that April's his mom, so Charles is just like bringing him around so that she can still get some sort of interaction with him. Did he like make a weird pass at her at like a Christmas party, like a staff Christmas party, like years ago when she was like an intern? And then like, oh my God, oops, got her pregnant, and like they had to sort of deal with this secret love child who, and she's like, I still want him in my life, but I'm not old enough to raise a kid. Like, I might, and he's like, I don't want to put you into that. So we came up with this whole big theory that like Danny is the secret illegitimate love child of April and Charles.
The best part is that
people
works.
Enjoy to varying degrees.
It works. That's the best part.
It totally works. Part is that it fits in the story.
Yes, it totally works. It totally makes sense.
And It explains a lot too.
It does. It does.
And then there's one with Casey Jones, but I'll let you guys tune into the show to hear that one. Cause let's tease that one. Gets a little morbid.
That one. who put that one out? Who came
that was, I think it might've been like, Chris and I might've tag teamed that one. Yeah. I think we sort of came up with that on the fly.
Yeah.
As we were recording one day, all I'm going to say is this: why are Casey Jones sports items so small? They're not your average size sports items.
No.
Tune in and find out.
I'm not going to say anything. Oh, so good. So good. I told that one to my wife the other day and she,
oh my God, how did she take it?
She's kind of like,
I'm so sorry.
Thought about it for a little while and she's, huh, I can kind of see that.
I guess.
Yeah. I guess. Okay. Okay. all right. So, let's see. We talked about the score. Fantastic. We talked about, the theories. We talked about the special guests that you guys have had. We know that it's, that we've got season two coming up.
Yes.
I wanted to do one little fun thing here.
Ooh. Okay.
We're going to call it Name That Minute.
And basically, man.
I'm gonna throw a couple seconds, and you don't have to guess the exact minute because that would be...
do I get like a 10 minute range or like a 5 minute range?
let's just do this. You can describe what's going on, and I know you're gonna be able to handle this. So
I'm good. I just let you know I don't have any of my notes up. I've got nothing. I'm sitting in front of the computer screen, and all I see is Skype and my own voice recording happening. So I'm not cheating on this.
All right. So we'll start with an easy one here. I think this is an easy one, right?
A loony. Okay.
Why?
Oh, I don't know. Because I wanted to redecorate.
All right, so what's going on here?
So April is laying down on the couch. Oh, you know, a couple of throw pillows, a TV news reporter. What do you think?
Perfect.
Why? Why? I can quote the whole movie for you. Yeah, that's got to be – okay, time. I can tell you that we did a lot of analysis of the Turtles' lair. I can tell you that there are at least two Domino's Noid figurines in the Turtles' lair.
Oh, my gosh. The Noids. Yes.
I can tell you that all of the clocks that you see in the movie seem to like be accurate to when the events in the movie would be actually happening. Like time progresses like correctly in the film.
Yeah.
There is a clock in the Turtles' lair somewhere, I think. I want to say this is like minute 23. Three, maybe?
21. Oh my gosh. That was fantastic. That was really good. That was really good.
All wow. Right. Go me. I feel really happy.
That was impressive. All right. So let's see here. Let's go.
Oh, this is – I feel like I'm on The Tonight Show or something. I didn't know I was going to get to play a game. This is fun.
Good. We're all about fun here. All right.
That's all I get. Okay, so Leonardo is meditating. He flashes on Splinter, and then it cuts to the close-up of Leonardo, and his eyes bug open wide, and then he runs in to the farmhouse. He tramples over the Trivial Pursuit board. What Russian novel set during the Napoleonic Wars, you know, War and Peace, stumbles over, and if I remember correctly, I think a couple of the Turtles – Trivial Pursuit pieces actually match the color of their bandanas, I think. I remember noticing maybe Donatello was at least playing with the purple one.
He is playing with the purple one. Yep. Very good.
Oh my God. Okay. That's tough. That's like right before they go back to New York.
That's it. Yep.
Because now they do the campfire scene.
Yep.
It's before they go back to New York. Oh man. I'm like the number 50 something is sticking in my head, and so is 70 something. I wonder if 70 something is too late. I'm gonna say 58.
Oh, dude, 59. Goodness. God. Wow.
Well, oh my God,
dude.
Let this be. Can we use this? Okay. Public service announcement: don't do a Movies by Minute podcast. You will become far too familiar with the film that you are studying. to an unhealthy degree. That surprised even me.
That doing very well. Very well.
All right.
Okay.
Oh my God, I'm sweating.
All right, let's do one more here. Okay. This one's going to be a little harder. All right. Let's see if you can get it. Just this one. Okay, let's play.
Okay. I do hope there were more of them.
Oh, wow.
That's the sewer fight. I recognize the steam gives it away. The steam is, and the lack of music also.
Fantastic.
Because most of the other fight scenes in the movie have some sort of scoring underneath them. So this is, they're in the sewer and you see the hands open. Do you see the hands open the valve or just close? All I know is the foot busts into the sewer and then the steam hits them and the screen goes white and you hear all these whooshes and woos and hi-yahs and, you know, thuds. And then I think the hands close the valve.
Yes, they do.
Which I always thought was funny because the wrists, whoever's wrist is closing the valve, like their wristband tape is loose. I remember something like dangling off of the wrists, which you don't notice in other scenes, almost like it was tied onto their wrist. So these are the details I remember. And then the smoke dissipates and Raphael is eating an apple. And our co-host Adam was always one to say – whenever someone's eating an apple in a movie, it signifies that whatever they were doing is so easy that they don't even have to pay attention to it, which I thought was a really interesting point. Adam went to film school also, so he had that perspective on our show also. Okay, that's got to be minute like 72.
Oh, it was. Dude, 72.
I was right.
You nailed it. You absolutely nailed it. Wow.
Oh, my God. I wish I was cheating. This frightens me a little bit.
You've gotten closer and closer with each one. I'm amazed.
We have to stop now because we've reached the point of diminishing returns.
This
makes me look super cool right now. To a Turtles fan.
To Turtles fans, absolutely. fantastic.
To everyone else.
Wow.
That was fun. That was cool.
Well, I mean – I figured if anyone's going to be able to do this, it would be you guys. So
I'm going to go back and brag to all the other hosts. I kind of want them to come on and see if they can do that too. We're going to have to get them on your show, and you're going to have to do that with the other guys.
Sounds good.
We're going to have to make that a little in-house competition.
Well, before we sign off here, we do like to do one thing with all of our guests onto the Turtle Power Podcast, which is have them answer the Great Turtle Power Podcast questionnaire. Great is, of course, in quotes.
Oh, man, is this going to be like inside the actor studio?
A little bit.
Awesome. I'm so excited.
All right. First question. How did you become a Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle fan?
So our very first episode that we recorded of our show is a pilot, and we asked all four of our hosts this question. So let's see. I don't remember what I said then, but I'm going to tell you this. I became a fan, I think, from the cartoon show and the toys originally. When I was a kid, and all my birthday parties as a kid, I still have photos of me like dressed up as a turtle for Halloween. All my birthday parties were turtle based. I played the arcade game. Like, I was big into the cartoon. When I started buying comic books in middle school, I went back and got real deep into the Mirage comics. And that was probably after a lapse of turtle fandom. Like, when the TV show sort of went away, I kind of didn't think about it for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
And then I got into like late middle school, early high school, and all of a sudden was like, I'm okay with being a Turtles fan again. I'm going to buy the old Mirage comics off eBay. And then I have been into it since. So gateway drug was the TV show.
I think that's a common answer for our demo.
It seems to be fairly common because we ask the same questions.
Your favorite character in the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles multiverse?
Oh, man. Favorite character in the whole multiverse? I mean, Casey Jones in this movie is pretty awesome.
Pretty awesome.
So he's up there. I mean, I always struggle picking a turtle because it depends on my mood. Like, sometimes it's Michelangelo, sometimes it's Raph.
Mm-hmm.
Very rarely is it Leonardo.
Mm.
So Mikey, Raph are kind of the big two. And then Casey's really up there as well. I'm trying to think if there's any others. I really liked the Fugitoid from the 2000, the recent cartoon, not the Rise, but the Nickelodeon cartoon
with
David Tennant playing.
Yes. Yep. Yep.
As I am staring on my desk, my figure, my vacuum metalized Fugitoid figure with a box that has a head drawn on it by Peter Laird.
Oh, very nice.
Turtle head.
Very nice.
Yeah. So that's one of my prized possessions.
Very good. Yeah, I've got a signed comic from Peter. That you mentioned earlier.
I have one of those too.
Yeah, that is a.
I didn't meet him though. That was like he mailed it to me. Yes. I have one with like Jim Lawson, one of the volume four books that Jim Lawson sketched on the back cover of too.
Very nice. Yeah, that was. I would. You mentioned earlier that would be an ultimate one for us to get Peter.
I know.
Yeah.
He's. I think he enjoys his privacy these days. So I'm not. That's. I don't want to bug that guy.
Absolutely. Which turtle are you most like?
I am. Oh man, that's tough. Okay, so I want to be, I think, most like Michelangelo. Like, I think I have the sense of humor mostly of Mikey slash like 80s TV show Raph, that sort of sarcastic thing. So, yeah, I'd probably like 80s TV show Raph is probably my closest personality, with like sprinklings of the goody two shoeness of Leonardo. Like, I didn't drink until I got into college. Like,
sure. Well,
I never got in trouble.
Talk about another role model for the community, Rob Paulson.
Oh my God.
Fantastic.
I would love to interview him someday.
Oh, he's awesome. Again. He's so nice.
Oh, you guys had him on?
Yeah. I was able to interview the entire cast, the entire original cast.
Catching up to do.
So you already mentioned this one. Your favorite incarnation of the Turtles is this film.
Oh, yeah. TMNT 90. It's perfect. It's got everything from all the other iterations that you love. It's got the humor of the cartoon. It's got the drama of the comic books. And it ties in the family aspect from everything. And it actually does that better than all the other ones. I think it makes the Turtles, ironically, more human than any other form of media has ever done.
Ooh, that's good. Yeah, goosebumps after that. That's good.
Ah, yeah, you can borrow that one.
Most underappreciated aspect of the TMNT.
The most underappreciated aspect?
Yes.
You know what? I'm gonna say that again. The family dynamic,
yep.
And specifically like the individual characterizations. I think the first Michael Bay movie really tried to establish the fact that they're teenagers and that they're brothers, but I don't think it developed each individual turtle very well. It moved so fast through the story that you kind of got whiplash trying to figure out who these characters were.
There was a story in that movie?
There is. The first one is better than the second one.
What? The second one is totally better than we're splitting hairs comparatively speaking.
This bad movie is worse than this bad movie.
Okay,
we did do a drunk commentary to Out of the Shadows on our podcast.
It was fantastic.
So
I thoroughly enjoyed that.
Check that out.
That was very good.
But yeah, I think the most underappreciated aspect is the fact that each turtle has their own sort of individual role and character, and you know, they also have this identifying thing as a family. Like, they are brothers, they're kids. Don't forget who these characters are. They're not just ninjas with, you know, good comic timing. They're like unique individuals with their own feelings and, you know, ways to attack a problem and relationships.
That's a great answer. We have we always like to do a guest specific question. So for you, obviously it would be, what is your favorite minute or minutes of any TMNT movie?
Favorite minute of any movie. Oh no. That's tough. I don't even know that I asked our crew that question. Favorite minute of the movie. Okay, I gotta think back through all 90 some odd minutes now. I mean, it might be.
You don't have to say the actual number.
I'm starting to think that way now. I'm like, I think it's like minute 51. I might have to stretch it over, but the sequence where April is describing each of the turtles with the voiceover, like that really weird super 90s like guitar in the background. And April, it's the only point in the whole movie that has a voiceover, and all of a sudden April's also like a graphic artist for some reason.
Yep.
But she's describing all the turtles, and Donatello, this might actually, I might be mixing two scenes, but there's also a scene where Donatello is outside the farmhouse humming Old MacDonald.
I think that's part of that little montage.
But he notices he's wearing a cowboy hat or something, but he notices something on the ground and like is taken aback by it and then continues. It's like, it's such a weird little sequence, and it's such a tiny thing to gloss over, but like that little instance of this film, I think, captures what this whole movie does best. Is it gives you like, it's like that's a real life thing that would happen. Like, oh my god, there was something in the grass. Wait, is there? Oh no, it's okay. Like, what other movie, I don't care if it's Turtles related or not, but what other movie takes the time to add in little things like that? It's so good.
Yes.
And like, you know, that stuff was planned. Like, we talked to Steve Barron about this stuff, and he's like, we really wanted to have moments like that where it showed that they're, again, you know, like, for lack of a better term, it showed their humanity. So I think that one, the scene where Donatello is humming Old MacDonald. Also, it makes me laugh harder every single time I see it, exponentially harder every time I see it, because I know it's coming.
Yeah.
And I'm waiting for it, and then it happens, and it's always funnier than I remember it. I just think of the guy, I think of Leif Tilden in the suit, just like doing that action, and the puppet having, like the puppeteer having to work the, all that work for such a little tiny throwaway scene. It's brilliant. It's absolutely brilliant.
Absolutely. We'll finish up with how can people get in touch with you and
the plugs. All right. So you can get our show on Apple Podcasts. Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Minute is the name. I think we're on Stitcher. We might be on a few other podcast services. I don't really remember which ones we're on. But if you Google Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Minute, you will find us. We are on Apple Podcasts. You can get at us on Twitter at TMNT Minute. We're also on Instagram at TMNT Minute. You can join our Facebook group, the TMNT Minute Listener Facebook group or listener feedback group or something like that. You'll find it. I was not prepared. Sorry.
No.
And we're always – we love interacting with everyone online through social media. You'll get either me or Chris or Adam or Rachel. Someone will respond to you if you shoot us a message. And I mean, keep your ears peeled for the second season, where we're going to be going through TMNT 2, The Secret of the Ooze.
Oh, I can't wait for that.
I'm very excited.
Well, if you need an extra co-host for
we might be able to work something out. Right. I think we could probably come to an agreement on that.
All right. Well, so I just really want to thank you for coming on because, you know, you have such a an insight into this film that, you know, the general public just isn't going to. No, let's put it this way. No other person is going to go through this film 1 minute at a time with the amount of detail that you all have. So,
well, we are happy to have done all the legwork for everybody. Yes. But you know what? I'm curious because I noticed that when we watched the show after doing this, when we watched the movie after doing this show, it completely changed the way we watch it. It also made the movie much shorter. Like, it went by so fast when we just sat down and we got together in Philly at the end of our show. Our season finale was, you know, the four hosts in a room drinking, and we did a commentary for this film also.
Yep. Yep.
And that's on our podcast feed also, but it went so fast. So I'd be interested to know if you listen to our show, you know, shoot us a tweet or get in the Facebook group and let us know what it feels like to watch the movie after you listen to our show.
Yeah, the amount of, cause it's a thing where like, I feel like I've seen that movie, you know, 500 times, and then listening to your show, it was like a whole new movie. I mean,
it's like, I've never seen the movie before.
So many more details that you guys, you know,
why are there so many noids?
Why are there so many
noids? We counted five.
What's the deal with all these noids?
Why are there so many noids? There's a noid in the phone booth. There's a noid behind the couch. What does Jerry Seinfeld have to do with the Ninja Turtles?
It's New York. It's New York, right?
It all goes together.
It all goes together. Scott, thank you so much for joining us. And we'll talk again.
Thank you for having me.
Yes, absolutely. We'll talk again soon.
Thank you. Take it easy.
Yep, you too.
Please, a moment to reflect.
A big thanks once again to Scott Tofte for coming on the show. And obviously, if you haven't already, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Minute, so good. Definitely want to recommend our friends over at Turtle Soup. They're currently reviewing the 1987 animated series Season 7. Our friends over at Turtle Flakes. If you haven't seen a new episode from them, just go ahead and update your feed. They had a change over there. They just interviewed Dan Berger from Mirage and Archie. That was a really interesting interview. The Turtle Power Pod, Basim and Cranny, just reviewed the 87 animated series Season 4, Episode 26. Ninja Turtle Power Hour is talking Rise of TMNT Issue 00 and also reviewing the 2012 animated series Season 5, Episodes 11 through 13. And TMNT Der Talk, which is TMNT The Talk, in German, is back and with a look at the different pets that the Turtles have had over the years. And, of course, TMNT Minute Season 2 is coming soon. Let's close off this episode with a song of the show. It's going to be... this is a special one because I actually got to see this in person when I interviewed the original animated series Turtles voice cast here in Orlando. Gosh, what was that, 2014-ish? One thing the Turtles like to do is sing the Turtles. Now the Turtles, not the Teenage Mutant variety, but the band that was, I think, the '60s is, when they were around. And, the cast likes to sing some of the songs from the Turtles. And so, I got to witness this in person, and now, Cam Clark, actually, has a video of the Turtles singing the Turtles and posted up on his Facebook. So we're going to go ahead and play that for you. So for Darby and Alex, who hopefully will be joining me next time, this is Ryan signing off and saying we'll talk to you next time.
Guys, it's Cam. And Mom, look what followed me home. Can I keep them?
What? Who are these guys but the original Ninja Turtles?
Hi.
Mom,
Tony, and Barry. And one of the things we've done a lot when we've been backstage and messing around is we always sing a song by the Turtles. Most of you have no idea who they are.
Yeah.
They were a big rock group in the 60s, and we've never put it on film or whatever this is.
Yeah.
This is film.
Whatever this is.
Yeah. So we're going to sing it for you now. You'll love it.
Yeah. You promise.
Okay.
1, 2, 3. Imagine me and you. I do. I think about you day and night. It's only right to think about the girl you love and hold her tight. So happy together. If I should call you up in the best of time, and you say you belong to me and ease my mind, imagine how the world would be so very fine. So happy together.
Hey guys, make sure to check us out on our official website, www.turtlepowerpodcast.com.
Also, follow us on Twitter at TMNT Podcast.
You can follow me, Ryan, at Big Don Pat.
Follow me, Alex, at A. Rodriguez 2005.
Follow me, Darby, at Darby T. Patton.
Like us on Facebook, facebook.com/TurtlePowerPodcast.
Make sure to subscribe on our YouTube channel at www.youtube.com/TurtlePowerPodcast.
And also share your feedback with us via old-fashioned email, turtlepowerpodcast@gmail.com.
Subscribe and rate us on iTunes.
And don't forget to subscribe and listen on Stitcher.
This program is powered by Tascam. Tascam's mini studio creator, US 42, is your new personal production and online broadcast studio featuring a professional quality audio interface and a number of unique real-time effects. The mini studio creator delivers everything you need for your podcast or webcast. Find out more at Tascam.com, part of the Gibson family of brands.